Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 14th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2024. The first item on the agenda is making a decision on taking business in private. We have the consideration of whether to take items 3 and 4 in private. Item 3 is to consider the evidence we will hear today with the Climate Change Committee. And item 4 is to consider our work programme, including an initial approach to our scrutiny of the Land Reform Bill at stage 1. Are we agreed to take those items in private? We are agreed. Our next item, therefore, is an evidence session with the Climate Change Committee to discuss their annual report for 2023 on progress towards Scotland's emission reduction targets. The session is also an opportunity to explore with our panellists last week's announcement by the Scottish Government on Scotland's climate change targets made in response to that report. I'm very pleased to welcome the Climate Change Committee, Chris Stark, the Chief Executive, and Professor Keith Bell, Scotland's champion. Thank you both for joining us. Chris and Keith, I think you're going to make some brief opening remarks, and I guess, Chris, as it's your last opportunity, you'll be going first.
I'm very happy to go first, and let me say thank you once again for the invitation to speak to you. I'm glad to have one more go on the waltzers before I head off from this job later this week. I'll be very brief. We published our annual Scottish Progress Report late this year. We did so because we had hoped to review the Scottish Government's new update to its climate change plan, and we don't have a climate change plan to review. So the central concern I have and the central concern I have always had in this job is that policy really matters in this area. If we want to reduce emissions, we need policy to steer what happens in the private sector and to steer the incentives to decarbonise in the Scottish economy. And that is extraordinarily difficult when all we have, in the main at least, all we have is consultations and promises. So we were pretty critical, well, we were damning actually, of the Scottish Government's performance in our progress report. And what has happened since is a series of events that changed the landscape for climate quite substantially, I think, when it comes to net zero, particularly in Scotland. We said in our progress report two very important things. One, that the annual target for emissions reduction had been missed again, meaning that it was the eighth time in the past 12 years that the target had been missed. And more important than that, we said that the 2030 interim target that had been set to reduce emissions by 75% from 1990 levels was beyond credible. And we thought very, very carefully about whether to say that and how to say that, but we felt that the time had come for us to call that target out. It would require a ninefold increase in recent rates of decarbonisation in the Scottish economy if we were to hit it. We don't see a policy package that could deliver anything close to that, and therefore we felt it was important to say that we felt the target could not be met. What has happened since is the final point I wanted to make in my opening statement. I feel I want to say, firstly, that credit is due to the Scottish Government for acknowledging that the 2030 target cannot be met and for taking the no doubt difficult step of announcing that to Parliament. And indeed, I think credit is also due to them for retaining, as I understand it, the 2045 net zero target, but leaving open the idea that a new path can be found to it on the advice of the Climate Change Committee next year. But these are very dangerous moments, I think. This is the first part of the United Kingdom that has felt it has to withdraw targets under any of the climate change legislation that we have. And my biggest worry is that we find ourselves in the position where we have, in a sense, an empty vessel act. We have a 2045 net zero target in law, but we have nothing much beyond that for the next few months. And my experience in the 6 or 7 years I've done this job and in the time prior to that in the Scottish Government is that when you have a vacuum around a topic or a vacuum around an area, it is often filled with, you know, the sort of nefarious voices on this. And I would not wish to see that happen. So we are entering a period when we will shortly see a bill brought to the Scottish Parliament that will in a sense, redraw the Scottish Climate Change Act pretty fundamentally, although it was described as a minor change. It is, I think, quite a fundamental change. Keeping the 2045 target is reassuring, but not having something to guide the short-term concerns me. And I think, therefore, we need to look to the strength of the policies that the Scottish Government brings in the next 12 months to this Parliament as a test of how serious the Scottish Government really is now of its climate credentials. And that's what I'll be looking for. That's what my institution, the CCC, will be looking for. It's policy that matters. And my very final point on this, policy matters more than targets, but incredible targets cannot be met. And I am absolutely sure that that has been part of the problem, that we've had a target for 2030 that could not be met in any practical sense, and therefore a legal obligation on ministers that could not be discharged to provide a plan for that target. We must not find ourselves in this position again, because there is a credible path to net zero by 2045 that goes through ambitious targets for 2030 and 2040, but we need to be realistic about the steps that the country can take to get to that goal by 2045.
Thanks very much, Chris. I think there were two finalists there, and I thought we'd finally had the pleasure of your company, and I'm delighted you're back and being as pithy as you are. So, Keith, do you want to make an opening statement?
There's very little to add to that, I think, actually. I think Chris has expressed that very well. I would re-emphasise, I think, the pathway part of it. The pathway to a net zero target is absolutely critical. From the global point of view, in terms of the emissions that are already happening and the climate change that is built into the system, in terms of the credibility of the end target and kind of the pathway there and showing the commitment of policymakers, but also in terms of the sort of the supply chain and the transition, you know, a step change in a lot of these sort of things. These are big changes across society. A step change is not, you know, using this word, incredible or incredible, it's not conceivable. These things have to be ramped up. And the policies, as Chris said, have to be put in place to enable that. It's not just about public sector action, although critical as important as that is. It's also about setting the scene for private sector action. So this vacuum that Chris pointed towards has to be filled, I think, reasserting the importance of reducing greenhouse gas emissions, the importance of adapting to climate change, and putting the policies in place and delivering on them. So even if there isn't a target in the interim, in relating to 2030 and out towards 2045, policy has to be delivered, I think, as if there is a target, as if there are targets, because of the importance of that transition and that pathway. So that still has to be defended, it still has to be argued for, and the detailed policy still has to be delivered, developed and delivered. So we've been fortunate, I think, in having cross-party support for action on reducing greenhouse gas emissions. In this difficult period, challenging period that Chris has pointed towards, it's really important that cross-party support continues, I think, and that the voices in favour of climate action on climate change continue to be heard, the arguments are made, because there are lots of positives around this to do with transition to new opportunities across the economy, to good heating, cleaner transport, cleaner cities and environment and so on.
Thank you, Keith. And just before we go into questions, I just want to remind members of my register of interest in that I am a member of a farming partnership producing fine quality beef, which may have problems as far as methane is concerned. But just in case that comes up in the conversations this morning, I've made you all clear of that at the beginning. So, Chris, if I could come to you, but I'd probably just say at the beginning is the dust is still settling on the statement that was made by the Cabinet Secretary last week, and we heard that new legislation was coming in to replace the 2019 Act. As a committee as yet, we don't know what that will be, and we don't know what the time frame would be. So I think your warnings about making sure that it includes proper targets and a pathway with policies is probably pertinent. But we will see how that develops in the coming weeks. So, Chris, my first question to you, and probably an easy one. A lot of politicians were hearing that it wasn't possible for Scotland to reach the 2030 target by last year. When did you think it became clear that there was no way the government could reach their 2030 target?
The honest answer to that is this year. I mean, we had a deep concern about the setting of the 2030 target when it was put into law. We said that we didn't have a path to hit it, but we did make suggestions to the Scottish Government and Scottish ministers for steps that could be taken to go beyond the pathways that we had for the whole of the UK. And at that point, and Keith may wish to chip in, we felt there was still a route to it, albeit an unlikely one, but this year felt like it was a bridge too far. So we always monitor progress towards it. And in particular, this we've recently discovered a quite neat way of looking at the gap, which is to just look at the change in pace that's required to hit the 2030 target. We also did that for UK, incidentally. A ninefold increase when the low-hanging fruit, in a sense, has already been picked from the power sector, we felt is just beyond the pale. So we felt we had to say something this year, but the straws have been in the wind for a while on this. It's always been a target that has been on the upper edge of credibility.
So before I come to you, Keith, just when the climate change plan was delayed, did that not ring all sorts of alarm bells to you?
And I'm not in the Scottish Government, but I'm fairly confident I know the process that was happening within the Scottish Government, because the Climate Change Act is actually very clear about the obligations that fall on Scottish ministers. So they must produce a plan that, in outline at least, hits the targets. And if we can't produce a plan to hit the 2030 target, then I'm sure that will be the same problem internally from officials in their conversations with ministers. And in those circumstances, the Lord Advocate won't allow the Scottish Government to publish a plan that's not legal. So I think in this case, that is what's happened. In a sense, what that probably means is that this over-ambitious target has been holding up genuine action on this from policymakers. And that is a good example of where targets are, where you've got the wrong target, essentially.
But that plan should have been published in late 2023, so you should have had concerns last year rather than just this year.
We sought and got undertakings from officials that there would be a plan for us to review, and chose, including with some correspondence with this committee, to delay our annual progress report to this Parliament to allow us to review that plan. So that gives you a sense of how we felt it was planning, it was supposed to play out. So I don't mind saying there was quite a bit of disgruntlement within the committee about the fact that we had delayed. I mean, we take our statutory responsibilities very seriously in the Climate Change Committee, and we had to delay that publication for 3 whole months. It's not a good look, and we did so because those undertakings couldn't be delivered.
So, Keith, do you want to comment, and then I'll come back to you, Chris, on that?
Well, I think just the brief point that it always was challenging. I think if the Scottish Government had put its foot to the floor right from the very beginning and started to ramp up all the sort of actions across the key parts of the economy, even then it was still going to be difficult. But if you're on a pathway that gets you to a 75% reduction by 2031 or 2032, that's still worth having, even if it wasn't quite 2030. But that action, I mean, we're progressively more and more concerned as the actions are not quite coming. As Chris said earlier, consultations, or it felt like consultations about consultations some of the time. But in the end, it's all like a sort of paralysis in the face of this daunting challenge of getting everything to 2030. And when you get to a point, for example, where the time it takes to develop, for example, engineered removals, even with the most optimistic outlook, it's just not going to happen by a certain date, then you've got very strong reason for saying, well, it's just not credible.
So, Chris, just go back to this, just so I fully understand this. We were told the climate change plan was going to be delayed last year. Surely that was the moment, if it was not before, that the Scottish Government understood that they weren't going to meet their targets. So,
I can't speak for the Scottish Government. I'm pretty sure they'll have known about it before then, though. So
they misled the committee and this committee on the fact that a climate change plan was coming, knowing that they couldn't meet their targets.
I can't answer for them, but I do know that the legal obligation is very clear in the Act. So the minister must produce a plan that meets the targets. I mean, if it subsequently becomes obvious that it didn't hit the targets, that's a different matter. But you've got to have a plan that at least in outline hits those targets. And I'm sure that was one of the difficulties in putting the plan out.
So, comment in there, I'm going to pick up on, Chris, you're pretty sure they knew about it before then. When do you think they did know?
genuinely don't know, because we were right until the second half of last year, we thought we were going to see a climate change plan that we would be reviewing in our update. So, you know, I'm genuinely not privy to the discussions that took place within the Scottish Government on that.
And I do remember you saying to the committee when we had our annual review that you would be reviewing the plan, which is why you were delaying.
That's right. We would have produced, believe me, for reasons of resource planning, it was a much better thing for us to produce the Scottish Progress Report at the tail end of last year than it is right now. So, you know, frankly, we were annoyed for all sorts of reasons about the fact that we didn't get that plan. But the delay was not helpful to us in any way. We're in the midst of an enormous programme of work at the moment for the next UK carbon budget.
OK, so it sounds like we were both misled. Me as a committee
member. Your words,
you,
not mine.
And you as a committee. Monica, no, Jackie, you're next with some questions.
And if I could come back with a
thought
on what you were saying just now, I would be interested to hear what your views would be on what it would have actually have taken to have reached the 2030 target. You're saying that things needed to be ramped up, the pedal needed to be put to the floor, but what does that mean in real terms?
So, shall I have a look at that, Keith, or do you want to pick it up?
Well, I can have a first go and fill in the bits I miss out, but the biggest emitting sectors, we've seen lots of progress in electricity, that has continued. Industrial emissions in buildings, in transport, and in land use and agriculture. So all of those things need to see a lot of action. Things like replacing heating systems in buildings, you know, homes and commercial buildings. Yes, starting to get action on land use, peatland restoration. Those rates have not been what they should have been. Planting new trees, some sort of plan to kind of reduce the number of miles travelled by combustion engine vehicles. Again, lots of nice words. You know, I think the 20% reduction in car kilometres is a great aspiration. I'd love to see policy come out that we can think will deliver that. So we've seen those four big sectors, aside from electricity, just basically flatlined in the interim. But even if we did all of those things and got the supply chains up and got the public transport systems moving, modal shift, in terms of the way people move about, it's still going to be really hard. And then this is where the importance of engineered removals, you know, the kind of bioenergy and carbon capture and storage, that kind of thing. So very challenging from the point of view of where the biomass is coming from and land use, and from for the engineering of the carbon capture and storage, which we're still not seeing at scale. Okay, so the Acorn project is starting to get developed, a couple of things down in England. But we know that's all taking time. So, it was always very challenging. Don't Chris add anything?
Yeah, there's a quite a useful and concise letter that we sent to the then Cabinet Secretary, Rosanna Cunningham, in late 2020, which made several points, and it's worth reviewing that. We can pass it on after this in correspondence. But what it said is, firstly, the 75% target goes beyond anything that we have in our modelling. Secondly, if you want to hit it, we think there is a way to do it, but we haven't been able to model that perfectly because, it goes beyond even our most advanced pathway. So essentially what we were saying to them is, you need to do everything that we have in our most ambitious pathway, which includes all the things that Keith has just talked about, decarbonising transport, the built environment, industry, farming, etc., etc., in line with our UK-wide scenarios. And you need to go further. And we named four or five areas where we felt it was possible to go further and put those on the table as speculative options for Scottish ministers to pick up if it wanted to hit the 75% target. And those were going faster on what we call greenhouse gas removals. That is an engineered process for taking carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere. And we felt there was opportunities to do that through what's known as bioenergy with carbon capture or direct air capture. That was the first. The second was an early start to the decarbonisation of the Grangemouth cluster. Now, of course, Muse has moved on since on Grangemouth since we produced that letter. But we felt there was an opportunity to go faster on the Grangemouth decarbonisation plan, albeit that's an expensive step. Thirdly, we talked about what's called early scrappage. And this is essentially where you've got a high carbon asset in use, taking it out of use early. So you could think about a good example of that might be boilers or cars. So some sort of scheme to take those off the road or out of action and replace with something cleaner. Again, these things don't tend to be cheap. And the last thing we talked about was a particular technology called hybrid heat pumps, which is basically something that sits alongside an existing fossil fuel system but allows you to use a heat pump for the majority of the year, so essentially using a smaller heat pump alongside, say, a gas boiler, and that allows you to roll that out immediately, so you don't have to close down a gas grid to have a hybrid system in play. Now, all of those steps are meaty, difficult things to do, but at the time we sent that letter, they presented a path to the 75% target. They were not picked up by Scottish ministers. I suspect the reason they were not picked up by Scottish ministers is because of wider events, post-pandemic, and, of course, with the subsequent crisis following Ukraine, and, of course, the following cost of living crisis. Nonetheless, they were on the table at the time when the target was set.
Okay. Speaking about the cars being taken off the road, are you meaning the fuel cars or the electric ones?
The high carbon vehicles, so petrol and diesel.
Okay. And it's because there's carbon in electric cars.
There is, but it doesn't cause emissions. Okay. So and I think it's very important to say that although these are options, I fully understand why they were not taken up by ministers. These are not palatable options, and they're very expensive as well. So it is purely because the target was too high. You know, these are the sort of things that we didn't recommend for other parts of the UK, because they're so far out of, you know, kilter with the steps that we feel the country needs to take overall.
Okay, if I can.
I just want to add to that scrappage point, which I think is really important, about the pathway in the transition. So, you know, you might have a gas boiler, for example, that normally would last for 10 years, and you know, you're getting worried about it breaking down after that. You want to replace it before it breaks down in the middle of the winter. A car, you know, combustion engine vehicle, how long is that normally on the road? They're coming, they're lasting a bit longer than they used to, but what's that? Yeah, somewhere between 10 and 15 years. But so you want to replace, at the point you'd be replacing something anyway, replace it with a low carbon option. And as the kind of population of all these different bits of equipment changes and over time, you can see a gradual transition of everything being replaced with, you know, low carbon stuff. So eventually, over a period of some years, it's all low carbon. The early scrappage means you're taking something, you know, you're replacing a boiler after 5 years rather than the 10. So you're kind of writing off those other 5 years. You know, you would have kind of paid for it over that time, if you like. Getting a car off the road, a combustion engine car off the road after, say, 5 years or 8 years, you know, but it also applies to, excuse me, big industrial equipment as well. So, you know, it's a big thing. It's an extra cost, but you can do it. It is a way of going faster, albeit, as Chris said, it's an extra cost.
So, to reduce car use, has there been anything proven that approaches that's already in place that the Scottish Government could pursue in short and in the longer term?
We did a piece of work about 18 months ago, and it wasn't a big piece of work, but we've been looking at the Scottish Government's commitment to reduce car miles travelled by 20%. And, you know, as Keith says, that would be a major step forward. And it's very good to see that the Cabinet Secretary committed to publishing a plan to a delivery plan for that later this year with a date attached to it. And that's also good. So we should see that by October. However, I will say here, I am dubious about any plan being successful in delivering the 20% reduction. And the reason I say that is because the actual requirements are pretty big to pull that off, and we've got some evidence of other schemes around the UK and indeed attempts in Scotland to do things that are similar. But probably the most interesting of them is the London congestion charge. You would need to see every year between now and 2030, I think the target is, a scheme with the success of the first year of the London congestion charge in reducing traffic to believe that that target can be hit. Now, maybe they have a plan to do that in the Scottish Government. I would love to see it. But it's that took absolutely years of planning for London to introduce that. And we haven't had that kind of planning in cities across Scotland. We do have low emission zones, and actually that is a step into it. But one of the other challenges in Scotland is that we travel further distances because we are more rural. So it is an extraordinarily difficult target to hit. It doesn't mean it's not worth trying for it, but it is a very difficult target to hit. And I think I'll say one more thing on this, which is if the goal is to reduce emissions from transport, the quickest way to do that is to switch the vehicles that are on the road from high carbon to low carbon. Travelling less has an impact, but it is marginal in comparison with that switch from petrol or diesel to electric. So, you know, the goal actually, and I, again, I'll give credit to the Scottish Government, the goal needs to be to make electric cars and vans as appealing as possible as a prospect to deliver the emissions reduction necessary in the surface transport sector.
And what can the Scottish Government do to enable that switch over to electric vehicles happen that bit quicker?
I think users need to have confidence, especially I think in the charging infrastructure, that it's available, especially for people who haven't got off-street parking. So the on-street charging or destination charging as well, car parks at shopping centres, leisure centres and places of work and so on, and that those charge points are reliable. So, the range anxiety that people have before switching. I mean, often people experience, Chris, you've got an electric vehicle now as well, I think. But it takes a bit of planning on a long journey. And you get to a certain charge point and find it's not working, really scuppers things. And the word gets out about that. It doesn't take too many bad stories to kind of, mess up the kind of public perception of the whole thing. So it's got to be done well. I was noticing that the Competition and Markets Authority had an inquiry actually just a couple of years ago into electric vehicle charging, and they made some pretty particular recommendations on reliability, the need for regulation on that. And also on pricing especially of the high power charging, rapid charging. So again, so especially for the longer journeys, that rapid charging becomes really important. But the pricing is there isn't a really proper kind of competition that's driving down those prices at the moment. And the CMA was pointing towards some pretty uncompetitive practices in terms of the length of contracts and so on. So all those sorts of things are ways in which policymakers can improve the whole kind of outlook and the prospect of it. I mean, the market's been moving anyway, which is good news, although there were some numbers, I think, this morning I was hearing on the radio before coming over. Not looking quite so good just over the past year, but for the last few years, electric vehicles have been proving popular. Once people get them, they like them, and they get, so that's the kind of positive story that can get out. But it doesn't mean that you can leave everything to the market, especially, like I say, on the charge points.
Thank you, convener.
Bob, you wanted, I think, to come in on that, and then you've got some other questions.
Thank you, convener. Just double-checking there during Jackie Dunbar's line of questioning. Of course, the Scottish Government doesn't work in a policy vacuum. And in relation to cars, I'm conscious the Guardian reported in January this year that the UK government was lobbied by global car manufacturers. And also, just before that, the UK government moved its target for ending the sale of petrol and diesel cars from 2030 to 2035. So can we say a little bit about UK policy levers that might actually compromise some of the ambitions we have here in Scotland, and particularly with reference to cars, given that was the line of questioning, but it did make me think that we don't sit in a policy vacuum here in Scotland.
That's true. It's not a policy vacuum, and it's a market for sale of cars across the UK. That has to be recognised. It's very difficult for Scottish policy to be set independently of that. Excuse me, here we go again. The zero emission vehicle mandate, I think, is a powerful, potentially really powerful policy mechanism. So essentially requires the manufacturers to sell a growing proportion of their sale of new cars to be very low emissions, with a strong penalty for not meeting those targets. So you would expect the manufacturers to respond to that. Yes, it's not very good news that the target for getting down to no new, the kind of 100% low emissions vehicles and 0% high carbon vehicles, that date would push back by 5 years. But the market might be getting towards that anyway. There's a certain kind of tipping point that it's likely to be met as that proportion ramps up, and all the kind of infrastructure is there to support it. So there's some debate that could be had about materially the impact that 5 year delay does have, albeit, as I say, the mood music is not good around it, what perception it gives, but whether it makes a material difference, I think there's a bit of jury is out on that, I think.
Yeah, just a brief, I've been on the record, and I'm happy to be on the record again, of being very critical of what the Prime Minister achieved in the speech that he made in Downing Street last year on this topic. So he made a speech about net zero in which he said he wanted to go more slowly on this particular aspect of the transition. But in actual fact, he didn't change very much at all. So although he did change the dates by which we stop selling petrol and diesel cars and moved it from 2030 to 2035, you could already, under the prior commitment, have bought a hybrid out to 2035. So there hasn't really been that big a shift. It was sort of pure petrol and diesel, which, you know, is on the way out, frankly, anyway. But what he did was give the impression to anyone who's thinking about getting an electric car, you should wait. And I think you see that now. I mean, we track the monthly sales. And if you look at the proportion of sales of new cars that are electric, it's flatlined since he made that speech. It's still big, I mean, but it was on a very much steeper upward trajectory prior to that. And I think that is, you know, it's hard to know whether that speech itself had that impact, but I suspect it did. And I think the other thing to say is, just as Keith said, he didn't change the zero emission vehicle mandate on manufacturers. So he's also created a situation where manufacturers are having to produce more and more electric vehicles, but they're not being given, the purchasers and consumers of those vehicles are not being given the signal to buy them. So it's quite a difficult thing to have done. And I think I was very, very optimistic 12 months ago about the speed with which the electric vehicle transition was happening. And I think it has been slowed, sadly. It will track upwards very quickly when cheaper vehicles hit the market. But I rather wish we hadn't introduced this uncertainty.
I know the Cabinet Secretary has spoken about a four-nation approach. We need to work together on this. I'm also conscious this committee is here to scrutinise the Scottish Government. But does the Climate Change Committee, does it map that policy divergence in any way, or the different pace or tone of policy? So does something sit in the one place by which we can analyse that interaction between UK policy and Scottish policy to see what the impact has been to Scotland meeting its targets, just so as a committee we can get a better idea as to where we are.
And I'm afraid the news is that Scotland was already behind prior to that speech. So, you know, the proportion of sales in Scotland that were electric was lower than the rest of the country.
Can I just, before you expand on that, can I absolutely agree with you? Scotland just needs to do better. But what I want clearly is self-evident. That's undeniable, but I'm trying to.
We're
new to this committee. I want to know how we can map some of this stuff out with that interaction with Scotland and the UK.
So, yeah, some of it does get published, and we make some comparisons in some of the policy. I guess we could maybe, arguably, could be a bit clearer perhaps on making the comparisons, but we've certainly spoken in reports in the past. You know, we're pointing towards, okay, a few years ago, to areas in which Scotland seems to be setting a lead. And in the progress report to this Parliament, you know, in March, we pointed towards the heat and buildings, the draft bill and the strategy that was being developed as elements in there that potentially really powerful and potentially providing an example that could be followed across the other nations of the UK. So there are kind of positive and negative stories in the comparisons, and the comparisons can be useful, I think, in kind of highlighting where examples can be taken, good examples taken from one place, but also pointing towards where what used to be a lead is no longer a lead.
Bob, sorry, just before you segue, use that as a segue onto your next questions. The Deputy Convener is quite keen to come in a question on transport, and I'm keen to bring him in. So if this is the right moment, can I bring him in?
Thank you. Just a quick question. On the 18th of April last week, the Cabinet Secretary wrote to us as a committee setting out a number of steps the Scottish Government was going to take to address your concerns. And one of those was a plan to deliver approximately 24,000 additional electric vehicle charging points by 2030. I presume you would welcome that, but also await the detail. Is that a fair assessment?
Listen, as an electric car driver myself, I'm delighted to hear that, and I think it is the best tool at the disposal of ministers to support the faster rollout of electric vehicles, the faster rollout of which is something we should want to see in Scotland. So, the mandate will apply across the UK. The mandate actually is in line with what I think the Scottish Government is trying to pull off. So what we need to do is to make this, the consumer experience for electric cars, as simple as possible. And I can tell you, as a driver of an electric car, it's not simple, and in the charging infrastructure, it is not as good as it should be, so that those extra charge points will help.
So delivering them would be a significantly good outcome if that can be
very much achieved. So, and we very much welcome the Cabinet Secretary's commitment.
Thank you.
So, Bob, I cut you off in full flow. I apologise. No, back to you.
You're fine. You know, I thank you for allowing me the opportunity to explore the interaction between Scottish and UK policy. Let me come back in later and ask about the finances and that interaction and delivering on our climate change ambitions. But Professor Bell did prompt me for what I thought was going to be a segue in relation to the Heating Buildings Bill, but I'll just give you the question anyway, Professor Bell. In the 2023 progress report, you set out that the proposals for the Scottish Heating Buildings Bill were strong and that could act a template for other parts of that of the UK. So learning from each other, the nations and regions, absolutely. What was it that impressed you? What are the elements of that Heat and Buildings Bill that you thought could make a real difference?
So what I can remember of some of the detail, so some things about when there's a change of ownership of a home, that's as a time to kind of make sure that low carbon heating is in place. I think there was, and what's going on, some of the other elements that are in there that I quite liked. Yeah, there was sort of, I think on new homes that should be, again, low carbon, I'm a little bit worried about that as to whether it drives the right answer. For example, electric resistive heating, the old style storage heaters, may be very cheap to install, but expensive to operate. So it depends on, you know, the home, you know, how much heat it needs as to what the kind of, for the longer term, the right answer would be. So there's things like that which, okay, they kind of maybe place, might be a bit scary for some homeowners or home buyers, depending on what part of the chain you're in. But as a way of making sure the transition happens, I think potentially really, really powerful. And then, you know, continued support for social housing and so on, I think is always, yeah, continues to be important.
Yeah, I mean, let me pick that one if I can. I mean, I think this is potentially the template for the whole of the UK and indeed other countries around Europe to follow, actually. So it's a very important consultation that the Scottish Government is conducting on this. The thing I think that the element of it that we are most keen on is that it, first of all, makes it very clear that we will not have fossil fuel heating. That will be completely eliminated by 2045. Now, that might seem like an obvious thing to say, but we haven't said it before, so it's very important to say that. But secondly, just as Keith says, this very controversial idea that at the point of sale, there is an obligation on the purchaser to switch out a heating system from something dirty to something clean. That is the kind of step that over time delivers the kind of transition that we've just talked about, the smooth transition rather than the incredible transition. And the reason that I particularly like that is that it may appear to put a cost on the purchaser, but in reality it's putting a cost on the seller. So it should over time become factored into the sale price of that property. And it's the seller really that you would want to target given the huge increase in the value of property that we've seen over the last 20, 30 years. So in a sense, what you're doing is taking some of that increase in property wealth that we've seen over the last decades, using that to help pay for the decarbonisation of the building stock. And that is, I know it's a difficult policy to push through, but it's an incredibly sensible way to do it. And the other element of what the Scottish Government has consulted on that we are very keen on is another thing that we've provided advice on, which is to change the basis of energy performance certification of buildings so that we give more credit for those buildings that have been decarbonised. At the moment, the basis of the EPC across the UK is basically looking at energy costs rather than carbon. So, you know, that means that if you've put a heat pump in a building, you get more credit for that in the building appraisal.
Helpful. I know that the bill also is good obligations on the private rented sector in terms of energy efficiency standards ahead of, if you like, the social sector, given that there's a much larger path to travel to make properties energy efficient, I think by 2028, I think, within the bill. All these things will theoretically be, at the very least, a nuisance or a financial implication for either the owner of a property, the purchaser of a property, the owner of a business that's private renting, and we're all politicians around this table, and as soon as interest groups raise concerns, politicians can sometimes melt away with their commitment to net zero for political convenience.
Global warming, absolutely.
Indeed. Nice segue, yes.
And it's the financial bit is the important bit, the financing of. So I love it, the fact that, you know, Chris is an ex-Treasury official, can pull out that kind of, you know, those overall kind of economic implications. But the other part of the economic implications is once you've got a low carbon heating system, a heat pump, you know, the efficiency benefits of a heat pump, you know, you're using so much less energy. And if, okay, now there's a bit of a UK government dependency about the rebalancing and a reconstitution of the way energy is priced, energy market reform being a key part of that, you're the relative costs of gas and electricity. So if you're now using electricity and the volume of energy that you're using is a lot lower, then you should be seeing the benefits over time of that initial investment. And it's a one-off investment.
Yeah.
So, you know, although, you know, there's a lot of concern, rightly, because it's disruptive, it's complicated. I'm on that journey myself, trying to reconcile what different contractors are telling me about what I need to do in my house to install a heat pump, you know, replacing radiators, do I need to replace all the pipe work or whatever. So it does depend where you're starting from as to quite how much it costs. But you do that once, and then you can reap the benefits of, you know, if they're all the market structures set up right, the lower cost of energy.
Just one further point on this, because the fact that it's in law, the fact that it is a regulation that sticks, it will also make the financing of it cheap. And it will also allow the supply chain for the installation of these measures to grow. And that is, I think, the biggest barrier at the moment. If you want a heat pump, you're very difficult to find an installer at the moment. So all of those things follow this kind of step, which, again, I'll say again, is I know it's difficult politically to introduce something like this for the reasons that you've just described, but it will have a huge impact. Once we normalise the installation of this stuff, we know that after a sale, for example, that's when you do make renovations to a property. That's the point when you might replace radiators. It's very important, therefore, that you try and grab that opportunity as much as possible. And the other bit that I think is very clever about what the Scottish Government has consulted on is it said, look, there will be large parts of Scotland that are probably not suitable for heat pumps and should be connected to things like low-carbon heat networks, district heating. If you're in one of those zones, we know what those are now, and you can say, well, actually, those properties, you can wait for that to roll through. So it also gives a lot of certainty to the people living in those properties about how they will heat their homes in the future.
One final question. I should point out, we might be repeating your comments on the official report from today in a few years' time, once these matters come to fruition and there are obligations on the private rented sector and owners and purchasers and the like, that is important. We just need to do this. It's the right thing to do, and there's a longer term benefit for the business and for the homeowner also. But my final question would be, that challenge, that cost outlay, is challenging for a purchaser of a property or a small landlord or anyone living in a property just now. I think Professor Bell spoke quite a lot about none of this is cheap. So in terms of budgets at Scotland's disposal versus that four nations approach to working together to do this, Scotland's funding doesn't work in a vacuum either. Would it be helpful if the rest of the UK and Scotland worked in partnership and worked to Scotland's timetable, if you like, because I think that might release some capital to Scotland to allow us to do some of that stuff about identifying cash that we could give to support households, to support businesses, to do some of this stuff. So we're always sharing that cost between the private sector or the homeowner and the public sector, because that's the difficult situation that politicians find themselves in.
I think a partnership and consistency of policy and the messaging that people receive through the media, I think is definitely worth having if it's all pushing in the right sort of direction. So yes to that. Financing, I mean, yeah, kind of growing the market, as Chris has talked about, you know, lenders being willing to lend at kind of reasonable interest rates. But a lot of it is about unlocking the private finance that's already there. You know, okay, so, you know, it's people like me who want to spend the money on it, just want to have the easy way of doing it, you know. And then you get these kind of virtuous circle of the whole kind of, you know, sector kind of grows and it becomes easier. I think there is a place for... I think for you know, cheap lending, the extent to which public sector, whether, you know, a green bank or whatever, steps in and offers particular loans at you know, low interest rates because the private sector isn't doing it or whatever, I'm not quite sure. That's not my area of expertise. But you can imagine, you know, as a beneficial thing, but it's not a kind of a, it's not a grant. You know, there is a big difference between a grant and a loan. So enabling those who can pay it back over time to do so, allowing the where grants are offered to be targeted at those, you know, in fuel poverty, you know, most in need of it, and who can't get access to you know, cheap loans in other ways.
Yeah, to find a point on this, to achieve net zero, it something I often say when I talk publicly about it, lots of people think it's about not doing things, so turning off oil and gas, for example, but actually it's about building things. So it's a capital investment strategy that's required for the whole country. So clearly it's more successful if the government can put its shoulder to the wheel and put more capital into that. So I think, you know, absolutely, the more that the Scottish Government is able to deploy its capital line of expenditure to support net zero, the easier this will be. I think on this particular one, though, on you know, decarbonising buildings, at the point of sale particularly, I think it's less the case for social housing, the point of that measure is that you create the opportunity for essentially that to go on the mortgage. So you get a very cheap rate of lending for something that everyone will do eventually, something that everyone will do as a matter of course. And it's that kind of normalising of it that we haven't achieved. It's quite an exotic thing to do a decarbonised heat system in a property at the moment. And if it's exotic, therefore, we're not going to get, you know, big supply chains to deliver it. That's why it's important to put this stuff in law.
Actually, I would just say, it seems exotic here in this country, or across the whole of the UK. It's not exotic across the whole of Europe. You know, these are not novel technologies. I mean, there are new versions of heat pumps coming out that operate at higher temperatures so they can work. Okay, there's an efficiency disbenefit, but they can work. They can get you warm enough without the need to kind of really, really expensive insulation replacement or even replacing radiators. So there are options there, but it's important to say that this is not actually exotic.
Very helpful. Thank you, Kira.
Just before we leave that, and because Bob brought it up, again, going to just say members will be aware that I also rent houses. And so you mentioned about rental targets of 2028. So just so there's no debate on that. Before we leave this subject, quick question for you, Chris. I understand what you're saying about people upgrading when they purchased a house. I understand that. Of course, you're right, I would say, as a surveyor, that if you haven't upgraded before you sell it, you will depress the value. So on the information we heard yesterday, it may be average price of installing a heat pump is about £15,000 if you add in the insulation. And if you're starting from zero, which many houses in Scotland would be, I think my survey, rough survey across Scotland, suggested that 2 weeks ago, less than 40% of houses on sale in Scotland were EPC C or below EPC C. So there'd be a huge amount to do. So it could cost somebody, when they move into a house, £25,000 to upgrade it. It could be more. It could be up to £40,000 in a semi-detached property. So it will depress the value of the house because the surveyor will come along and say, you've got to spend £40,000, therefore it's going to be worth £40,000 less. And then the surveyor will come along and say, you don't have to spend £40,000 because it's already done, so you have to spend £40,000 more on buying the house because you've saved that money. So you are really going to affect the housing market.
Important point that you're right, some of this will work itself through. I mean, the ideal point is that we reach a point where it is just as a matter of course something that you consider in the same way as you might a new kitchen. You know, well, that's a nice kitchen, I'll buy that for more. You know, that's the kind of outcome we're looking for here. The really important point in your question is that it should not cost that much to upgrade those properties. The reason it costs that much right now is because it is still quite an exotic technology to install, and because the installer community charges you quite a lot for that when it happens. I do not believe that will remain the case. And you see much, much, much cheaper installs coming for, what, let's say, standard housing, which is still the majority of housing that we have in Scotland. You can look at the likes of Octopus, for example, who are dramatically decreasing the cost of an install. And I think that is what will happen. And I think the final thing I want to say on this is that we, as the people who work on climate change, are probably also changing our mindset about this. We used to have an idea that to achieve a fully decarbonised built environment, we needed to start with the fabric of the buildings. We need to improve the energy efficiency of those buildings and then get to low-carbon heat installations later. I don't feel that's necessary now. I think we should be thinking about doing this once and once only. We need to, I think, accommodate the fact that most properties will not achieve really high standards of energy performance, although there is still an option there. because, you know, there's marginal benefits once you get beyond EPCC. And the latest form of heat pump, I mean, it's not all about heat pumps, I should say. There's lots of good technologies out there that are not heat pumps. But if you look at heat pumps, they can cope with that very comfortably. You essentially, they're a straight replacement for a boiler. So we don't need to have these big capital costs. And I think the more that we normalise this, again, to use that word, the more that there is a supply chain behind it, the cheaper it will be.
So it's worth... Keith, just before you come in. To get the supply chain to ramp up to supply the heat pumps, are you suggesting we do what France does and say that the heat pumps that are installed in France have to be made in France?
Scottish jobs for Scottish workers is not the policy of the Climate Change Committee. I do think it's really good idea to have a domestic supply chain for this. And, you know, I do think there's a huge number of jobs in this. I mean, the point about the rollout of decarbonised heat and with it energy efficiency improvements is it has to happen in every town, village and city across the whole of the UK and the whole of Scotland. And that means it will be better done by a local supply chain.
Means the prices will come down for installation. Yeah. Sorry, Keith, I cut you off.
Well, yeah, I mean, the supply chain includes, I mean, the biggest bit of work, well, what, is it the biggest bit of work? Is installing, designing, installing, putting it in a particular home. So that the manufacturer of the heat pump itself, I don't know how many jobs are involved in which bit, but there's already a significant bit in the installation. So, yeah, I mean, I'm not sure about the idea of heat pumps installed in Scotland have to be made in France. I wouldn't agree with that. But, but sure, you know, to build up the sector looks like a good idea. Attract the manufacturers here looks like a good idea. we're talking a lot about heat pumps. Excuse me, quite rightly. Heat pumps are spreading now, sorry. But, heat pumps also work at an industrial scale. so we shouldn't forget about district heating, heat networks, especially in our urban centres. And a lot of Scottish cities have benefit of access to waterways. So we have an example, you know, down the Clyde, for example, of, you know, an industrial scale water source heat pump that works on a district heating scheme. So that's, you know, that's where you get your low carbon heat from. And you know, there is a big capital cost in heat networks, and there needs to be some way of getting enough anchor load to justify that and ensure that it can be paid back. But, you know, there's a lot of kind of, you know, tenements and whatever where actually that looks like, you know, the right option.
Keith, I hope you're going to last this session and that you've got plenty of water. The next questions, anyway, come from the Deputy Convener, Ben.
Thank you. Just on that, recently I visited a very interesting project that LAR Housing Trust had undertaken, where they have converted both an existing tenement building and a new tenement building with a district heating system through two British companies, one Scottish, Kensa, UK level, and SunAmp here in Scotland. So there is evidence of what can be done. On tenements, though, as a constituency MSP who represents a lot of tenement housing and lives in one myself, reform of the Tenement Scotland Act 2004 is really important in this, as well as the current consultation. And they, in my view, do need to be seen in tandem if we want to convert existing housing stock.
And that Kensa model, and I don't want to be a salesman for Kensa here, but it's a really interesting example, actually, of you know, a different way into this challenge. So the traditional view of district heating is that you put insulated pipes, big insulated pipes, in the ground, and you have a central source of heat. And where I live in the West End of Glasgow, I'm in a tenement, and we have the Glasgow University district heating network right next to us. I'm two blocks away from it. That's a big system. What Kensa's doing essentially is saying, look, we can take some heat out of the ground and we can install in every single property a smaller heat pump, which was very efficient because it takes the heat out of the slightly warmed water that we can circulate through boreholes. It's a very potentially cheap option, and it would work for tenements. Now, and this is the point I wanted to make, essentially, is that we're not lacking options here. What we're lacking is the requirement to do it, first of all, which I think the Heat and Buildings Constitution, if delivered, would present properly as a goal. And then secondly, an actual plan for, in my case, Glasgow. So I happen to believe that you probably would need to have some sort of municipal plan, because that's probably where the trust lies. People will see the Glasgow plan for heat. And if you go back to the 70s, when we switched to natural gas from the North Sea, it was pitched as a sort of national mission. It was very much an industrial policy as much as an energy policy for the consumer. And, you know, we're going to need to do something of that scale again. And I think people need to feel excited about that. And I think there's got to be some reason to be excited about it. So we'll have to present to the people living in Scotland that there is some benefit to this transition, not just to the climate, but to them too. These smarter energy systems can be cheaper energy systems. The fact that electricity is behind the heat allows you to do things that we can't do with gas, for example. That's exciting. But we've got to, at the moment, it is, I'm afraid, quite a miserable discussion that we have on this because it's all about cost. And I think looking at it as a national mission is exciting. We can do this.
I think it should be quite exciting to not have to depend on your rubbish electric storage heater that never worked properly in the first place. You know, so
we'll need to reform the 2004 Act, though, to enable shared owners to come together or compel them to, and to potentially have building bonds that achieve financial
policy action and the range of things which getting the policy levers in place, which are not all about commitment of capital in terms of getting the policy levers in place. So if tenement owners of flats, if there's a way of them coming together and mobilising their shared capital, then that's got to be a positive, I think.
The buildings. Are you about to leave buildings? Douglas wants to come in on buildings.
I mean, I'll just say very quickly, the Scots Law Commission are looking at a bill for the next parliamentary term to reform tenement law, and I think it's essential in this space, but happy to hand over to them.
Yeah. Thanks, Communer. I just wanted to ask quickly, Chris, you'd mentioned hybrid heat pumps that you discussed back in 2020. Now, for me, that doesn't seem consistent with the heat in buildings bill that's going to be coming forward. Do you still think they've got a place in terms of a bridging technology, or do you think that's now past and we should just move on?
I have to say I've gone full circle on this. I started my time in the CCC. One of the first reports we did was looking very actively at hybrid heat pumps. And just for the benefit of the committee, they're quite an interesting technology. We've seen them trialled at scale, at village scale, and they've worked really well. So basically you have an undersized heat pump, so not an enormous thing, looks pretty much like an air conditioning unit, sitting alongside an existing fossil fuel system or a biomass system. And what we found, there's a very good project called the Freedom Project in Wales that looked at a rural village. And the key thing is it didn't try to upgrade any of the energy efficiency of the buildings. I've been to see some of the buildings. You can almost see through the bricks. And what we found is during a very cold year, that was the year that we had the Beast from the East, if you remember that, it's a very cold period, the heat pumps, even in the very poorly insulated buildings, were still doing 80, 90% of the year, all the heat that was required for that property. And then essentially the fossil system tops that up. Now, I think that is a good option for two reasons. One, it sort of normalizes heat pumps. Basically, you get familiar with the fact that you've got a very smart technology that you can use in different ways and actually save money with it as well. You can do a thing called preheating if you've got a heat pump, which allows you to benefit from when the wind's blowing hard and electricity is cheap. I think it's good for people to get used to that. And then you can get to the full decarbonisation of it later. There is still time to do that with a hybrid approach, but only if you start now, because it comes a point where actually you should just jump straight to doing the full decarbonisation, or do it once and do it well. So I think there is still a window to do it. And I tend to think that this will get more and more difficult as we get to the really difficult stuff about how you actually close down a gas grid. You know, there's costs in that. There are vested interests. There are owners of assets that will want to see payment for that. The great thing about hybrids is it starts you on that journey, and it has a huge impact on carbon emissions because you get these very immediate reductions.
So in terms of that heat and buildings bill, do you think there could be an option in there to allow hybrid for over a certain period of time and then make the switch?
There's a lot of controversy about it, and I don't think there's a right answer to this, but certainly in work that we've done in the past, you see the benefits of hybrids. And as long as there is a plan to fully decarbonise at the end of it, then I think it is a good way to get going on it. I know there are differing views on this, but that is definitely where I've come to at the end of my time at the CCC.
I can add on that from personal experience that is emerging, because I've been trying, I mentioned earlier, I'm trying to get a heat pump installed. I like the idea of a hybrid because I'm kind of hedging my bets. I've still got the gas boiler, but the contractors, I've spoken to three different contractors, and they're giving me different advice on whether the grant that's available for putting in a heat pump is still available for a hybrid. And they're sort of tending towards, probably not. One of them is saying, I think people are using this as a sort of way of getting a grant, but they're still actually getting a lot of heat from the gas boiler, which is not what I'm trying to do. It's partly a backup in case something isn't set up right. But also, you know, on the really, really, really cold days, I can still be confident I'm getting enough heat into the house. You know, the gas boiler just adds a bit more heat to the system. And the control system can be configured to do that. It only kind of comes in if the outside air temperature goes below a certain level, for example. So I haven't read the detail of the rules for qualifying for the grant to check, you know, what interpretation I might make. I need to go and do that. But it shouldn't be kind of impossible to write the rules such that, you know, it allows this sort of heat, you know, hybrid configuration. But having said that, as I mentioned a little while ago, there are newer heat pumps coming on the market, which have still got enough oomph in terms of the kind of the temperature gradient that it gets from the outside and into the internal temperature that you want through the radiator system, which actually, even on the cold days, are not going to revert completely to a kind of just a standard resistive heater and draw loads of electricity from the network. That would be a worry for the network as well as for you as a bill payer. So they could still get, you know, operate in with a reasonable coefficient of performance. So I need to look into that myself in more detail. But, you know, it is a moving space, but we shouldn't be having the rules that kind of hinder what is a pragmatic, reasonable option.
OK, thanks, Convener.
We are going back to the Deputy Convener.
Thank you, Convener. Professor Bell, you said earlier about agriculture and land use. I just wondered if you wanted to say anything more on that. Your assessment suggests that the contribution of several of key actions in agriculture, forestry and peatlands are off track. What would Scotland need to see from the next climate change plan, and what would you need to see to provide certainty that there will be delivery in these areas?
Well, I mean, I'm not familiar with exactly what the barriers are to why it's not happening as quickly as it is happening. You know, we're being told that there's a lack of people in the sector, lack of skills. So, yeah, maybe the convener can tell us anything more from his personal experience on some of that. But certainly the targets need to be appropriate. Yeah, I think the Scottish Government's target, which the Scottish Government is not delivering on the Scottish Government's targets, and the Scottish Government's targets are lower than what we were suggesting would be a good target for afforestation. The mobilisation of capital, I think, again, is an important thing. You know, from what I hear and talking to all sorts of different people, there is money available. People want to invest in domestic capture of carbon, and they like it via natural means. There's a friend of a colleague who's trying to get into that sort of market and finding it very difficult to navigate the various regulations around it. There's a great will to mobilise private capital and get it in, but there needs to be the kind of the verification that this really is doing what it's supposed to be doing, and, you know, planting trees in a sustainable way that protects biodiversity and so on. So there is kind of machinery, if you like, around it to be organised and sorted out. Is my understanding.
Very briefly, I mean, we're going to produce next year some work on the next path for UK and Scottish emissions. And I don't mind telling you, I think it's probably going to have some interesting things to say about woodland creation in there, because we think there's more in it potentially than we thought even before. The challenge is that growing a tree is not something you can just turn on like a technology. So you've got to put something in the ground and grow it. So, and we also need to grow that on ground that at present doesn't have trees on it. So there's a set of skills and ownership issues that go with that too. But it looks more and more like woodland creation is something that we want to support, because you get an even bigger impact in the future, basically, from it than we thought. So I think the more we can do on this, the better. Obviously, public funding is a challenge. So I think the other challenge might be to bring in private funding for some of this. And we could think of sources to do that and interesting ways to do that too. But I know that's a controversial topic too. The other one is peatland restoration. And peatland restoration is almost the opposite of woodland creation, because you get an immediate bang for your buck. But essentially, you get a very quick carbon sequestration from re-wetting peat. So combination of those two things actually is an enormous benefit to the Scottish strategy overall for reducing emissions. And although there are costs in it, they're not huge costs. So I think, you know, there are strong support for any funding that can go that way from Scottish ministers.
That's very helpful, and we might follow up, convener, on some of that potentially. On agriculture, anything you want to add? I mean, campaigners have on a number of occasions brought up agriculture with myself, there's a lot of appetite in the farming community to be part of climate action, but also for producers and consumers, it might require some choices.
And it does. And I think the first thing I want to say, and I've definitely learned the lesson of talking about this in the right way over the 6 or 7 years I've done this job, this is not an issue that is the fault of farmers. Farmers do a thing that does cause greenhouse gas emissions, and they do so for all sorts of reasons, not least policy. So I think that the really important thing is that we need to bring along the agricultural community, and that, you know, it's not just farmers, it's all the people who work around them as well, with something that shows an equally lucrative future for them in a low-carbon way. My main criticism of the Scottish Government to date has been that and I think I've said this in the past, there's an element of magical thinking about how we reduce agricultural emissions, because you've got, from what we've already seen, at least from the Scottish Government, and I'm sure this will be updated, what you essentially look at is, you look back over time, you've got farming emissions essentially a flat line, and then something mysterious happens over the coming years and it starts to fall. But it seems to do that without the benefit of any policy. So, you know, the vehicle for this is the bill that we've got. And that will be a better platform with the post-cap support for farmers to do low-carbon farming. And there are some good proposals in there from Scottish ministers, but it's not going to hit home until later in this decade. So I suppose my main plea to Scottish ministers is, let's be serious about this. This is about a genuine change in practice. That takes time to roll out in the farming community. It needs to have their broad support as well. This is all happening at a time when we've got food security issues going on as well, which are themselves driven by climate change. So we need something that works for farmers and reduces emissions and gives a genuine livelihood to farmers in the future. And I think that can be done, but it wouldn't happen. Next week. So I think that the idea of doing this properly, but being genuinely cognizant of the fact that it takes time, is, again, it's one of these issues that the transition itself is not something you can just switch on overnight.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Commissioner. I was just going to ask quickly about the agricultural bill that you just mentioned there, Chris. You know, I'm trying to think how that can come forward now while we don't have a climate plan, or did you see any sort of problems around that?
Well, we don't need a climate plan to do anything, really. I mean, especially now the Act is going to remove the obligation to hit a target by 2030. So I suppose this is a good test of how serious the Scottish Government is about it, about what it's trying to do on climate. You know, maybe we only do things because of targets, but I rather hope we do things because actually every portfolio in the Scottish Government has some role in reducing emissions. And the area that will be the biggest problem from this, you know, the perspective of Scotland, when it gets to the 2040s and beyond, farming will be, if not the big, well, I think it probably will be the biggest emitting sector, because all the others will be close to zero. So this is something that is so fundamental that I think you don't need much more than the net zero target for 2045 to get going on it. And I think I'll say this too, lots of the work we've done internally in the Climate Change Committee on farming shows you that the kind of practices that you'd want farmers to pursue in that net zero society that we'll get to by 2045, save the farm money. So this is about, you know, to a huge degree, not wasting resources, investing in new kind of capital kit on the farm that is also low carbon. We should want to see those things happen for the benefit of, you know, good productive farming in Scotland.
I'll just add that point about whether there's a target or not a target. I mean, this is one of the kind of unfortunate things, I suppose, about a target that was overambitious, is it gives this perception that either you hit the target or you miss the target. It's this kind of digital, you know, it's on off, yes or no. But even though the last kind of climate change plan update, it didn't look like it was going to hit the target and it had some magical thinking in it, that doesn't mean that it was all rubbish. You know, there was lots of stuff in there that made a lot of sense and should be pursued. And action, you know, for example, in terms of transition in agriculture would be one example of that. Doesn't mean you don't get on and do it. And I agree with Chris, would be a sign of commitment on the part of ministers that to still do the things that should be done anyway to get on this pathway to reduce emissions across the whole economy.
Okay, thank you. I'll move on now, convener, to carbon capture and storage. Now, I think we would have all liked to, you know, to be further on, especially in the ACORN project. But in terms of if we were further on, would have the government met would they be on course for that targets that they'd set, or would have the carbon capture and storage delay, would have that made a significant difference when we look at that target?
I don't think we have done the analysis, at least formally, of whether we'd be on track for the targets that the Scottish Government previously had set for carbon capture. But let me just say they were punchy, to use that technical term. And I think it is highly unlikely we would have hit the CCS targets, and then in turn the greenhouse gas removal targets that are linked to them by 2030. One of the benefits of at least removing the pressure to hit the 2030 target is we can probably have a more sensible discussion about the pace of deployment of CCS, because the Acorn project is a great project, and I think we do need to have CCS in the mix, because it allows you to reduce emissions in the short term and then opens up this new industry that we don't have anything at the foothold of, which is the greenhouse gas removals industry. So we should do that as quickly as we can, but not to achieve fantastical targets by 2030. Probably the majority of emissions saved will come after 2030, once you've got, you'll get into a point where we've built the infrastructure, and then in the 2030s we'll see the benefit.
So not being further forward with the Acorn project doesn't really, the announcement we had last week, it doesn't really have an impact on that. Would that be correct? Or
I think it is possible for us to do carbon capture before 2030. I think the scale of it is unlikely to be big. So it is quite simply an infrastructure task, and it takes time to build that. Now, we've still got time. I mean, I'd love to see us go quickly on this. It would be a really, really good answer to the question that I'm often asked, why are we doing CCS? Well, the answer would be because it works. That would be, and I would like to see Scotland take a lead on it, because it's such a good place to do CCS. And again, the Acorn project is also good because it's a pan-Scotland project. You've got operations in Peterhead. You've also got things happening at Grangemouth. There's a pipeline there. I can see how that would work. And it opens up this new industry that we definitely do need of greenhouse gas removals. So I don't know what can be achieved by 2030, because we haven't done the numbers on that, but I think it will probably be still quite small scale by the time we get to the end of the decade.
Okay.
I think there is... It's come back to some of the danger of the 2030 target and all of the kind of debate and coverage around that. It's almost as if we're saying, oh, we've abandoned the 2030 target, abandon everything, all bets are off. No, that's absolutely not. I mean, something that Chris was talked about at the beginning, about the kind of political vacuum or the kind of vacuum in terms of public discourse. We've still got to get on and do these things. And even if Acorn doesn't quite, get the removals, the volume of removals by 2030 that we'd like to have, we should still be in a position of do what you can. Get the thing moving. If it comes in 2031 or 2032, it's still worth having.
And in terms of, obviously, the Scottish Government had committed, it was 80 million towards that project. Is there anything they could be spending on just now, or does that really... Does that really depend on how the UK government move forward with the Acorn project?
I think it does depend largely on the funding available from the UK government, because this is one of the pilot projects. However, a cautionary tale is the story that we heard from this week, that one of the SSE offshore wind projects didn't get consented in time. And I think the more that we can make sure the consenting regime for this, and I'm afraid I don't know what consents are involved in a carbon capture storage project in Scotland, I haven't had the chance to look at the project in detail. But let's not get ourselves in the position where it's the planning regime and the consenting regime that's holding this up, because I'm afraid a proud, or rather not proud, history of that being the case in Scotland.
Okay. Moving on to oil and gas licences. Now, obviously there's a big debate whether granting new licences would have any impact on our meeting our emission targets. Do you have a view on that? Because the committee has been, I would say, has gave sort of mixed views in the past.
I have a view, and I'm going to give... It's not a personal view, it's an informed view, but I'd feel more able to give it as I head out the door at the CCC. I think that collectively politics north and south of the border has just been wasting its time on this issue, and I think it's quite astonishing how much time it's absorbed. So the reason I say that is because, yes, we do have oil and gas reserves, and they are very important energy reserves that the country has benefited on for many decades, but they are running out. And if you look at the North Sea Transition Authority's projections for, you can look at gas or oil, but let's look at gas, because it's the one that we know we will need right through to 2045. They are projecting, without the new licences, a reduction in the production of gas from the North Sea of 97% by 2050, with the new licenses 95%. The issue is the fact that it's 95, 97. It's not the 2 percentage points, and yet that has dominated the political discussion of climate now for 2 whole years. And my biggest concern is that what that has meant is it's crowded out the discussion of how we get off the stuff in the first place. But when that's the main issue, because if we do not decarbonise, in sense that our demand for fossil fuels, if we don't switch to electric particularly and switch to hydrogen as something that we want to use in the Scottish economy, we're just going to be importing that stuff. And that is as much a climate issue as it is an energy security concern. So the oddity in Scotland and the UK is that we are, I think, fairly unique in the sense that our transition from oil and gas matches, because of geology, the climate transition that the world needs to make. We should be making more of that. That is something we'll have to deal with because there's the geology of the country doesn't permit us to keep producing after that point. And I slightly despair that we have this endless discussion about oil and gas licences when actually the discussion of heat pumps is much, much more important, than that discussion overall.
Yeah, so the key message is it's demand, not the supply. Supply will come from the North Sea or where it will come from.
It is, but I think it's important also to say that you have to acknowledge that the world's supply of oil and gas is already too much for the carbon targets that were set, for the Paris targets that were set in 2015. So we are all going to have to go on a journey of constraining supply in some way, otherwise we're going to blow those temperature targets out of the water. So, again, I think that does speak to the need to act more on demand, but it also, we're going to have to keep an eye on the supply side too, because if we get to a point where the global supply of oil and gas is so cheap that it becomes uneconomic to make the switch to low carbon, then that is as much a problem. So you've got to keep an eye on both. We are slightly less concerned in terms of our domestic supply for the reasons I've just described. We're going to be running out of this stuff over that period.
And I guess global supply is not something, okay, the UK can play a part, but not a significant part.
No, and I'm afraid that politicians in the UK rather overstate their importance in this discussion. There's not much that we can do to affect the global price of oil and gas. And I think, the lesson of the recent crisis that we had post-Russia's invasion of Ukraine is that we're price takers. And the extraordinary intervention that was made by the Liz Truss government to prop up energy bills was only necessary because we're so dependent on gas. So, it was a fossil fuel crisis. I mean, remarkable to me, as in looking back over the few years, that was described to me regularly as a net zero inspired crisis. It was absolutely nothing to do with net zero. It was to do with the fact that we're too dependent on fossil fuels. We should be moving as quickly as possible to remove that particular dependency. And the best way to do it is to develop a domestic low carbon supply of electricity, particularly, but more broadly of energy supplies, and use it domestically as well.
Okay. Thanks, Camino.
Thanks, Douglas. Monica, you've been waiting patiently for your time.
It's been worth it. It's been fascinating. Thank you, Convener, and thank you to Chris and Professor Bale for your really clear evidence and answers today. I'll just refer to my register of interest because I'm a member of two trade unions, Unite and GMB, because I'm going to ask about just transition and the green economy. Really keen to get your views on the efforts and progress government has made towards its commitment on just transition. We've heard a lot today about energy sector and agriculture, so perhaps those sectors might be good to start with. So just an observation from me is that I think it's really important that workers and communities have confidence that climate action and net zero will benefit them and not punish them. But the announcement last week perhaps leave people feeling more anxious. So really keen to get the Climate Change Committee's view.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right that people need to feel confident in this and feel that it's an opportunity rather than a threat. And it applies, we've talked quite a bit about, consumers or users of energy, buyers of agricultural products and so on. It's important that they get a reasonable price for whatever they're buying. So that's part of a just transition, very importantly. But yeah, jobs, of course, is another big part of it. Who is producing all this stuff? And what stuff are they producing? So we're trying to transition the economy away from high carbon to low carbon stuff. It is a difficult transition. I mean, a lot of the skills, I think, can be transferred. Think about the oil and gas sector, for example, or people with kind of technician skills can apply those skills in another area. They need the training and the opportunity to do so. So the support for training, not just by government, but also by industry, the industries that want to attract the people, and the investment is really important. And that comes back to the confidence point, that everyone is really serious about this. That's why I hear lots of people in the energy, lots of companies in the energy sector saying, we can't find enough people, not enough people out there. That it is a serious problem. But some of the companies are starting to step up in terms of the training that they're offering, the number of graduates they're recruiting and this sort of thing. But it's all a bit slow, I think, and it needs to come more of it. A challenge then about education, higher education courses. We've got constrained budgets. Are the people being attracted into the sectors? There's a wage inflation going on in the energy sector, a competition for people. From the point of view of individuals who can benefit from it, that's great. Finally, the renewable sector is starting to pay better wages and starting to compete with the oil and gas sector, I think. But the jobs aren't necessarily in the same physical locations. So there is nevertheless still a challenge there, families established in whatever locations. So starting to see the opportunities that have been talked about for a long time about, green jobs, as it were. But more action needs to be done to support that. And the locational aspects, the place-based aspects, are still a bit of a challenge.
So you said it's been slow, and earlier on we heard about the letter that Lord Deben sent to Rosanna Cunningham, and she was a cabinet secretary, I think that was 2020, so a previous parliamentary session, and one of the recommendations was about the early decarbonisation of the Grangemouth industrial complex, which is in my region, Central Scotland, but is of national strategic importance. Was that advice just not taken by the Scottish Government? Do you think they are listening to advice when they get it?
I can draw on some experience from being in the Scottish Government. I'm a long time ago now, but I was the Director for Energy and Climate Change prior to doing this job. And we've always worried about Grangemouth because it's one of the oldest refinery complexes in the world, actually, but in Europe. And that means, therefore, without investment, it's very obvious it's not going to be competitive. And I think Jim Ratcliffe and INEOS have taken a very cold-hearted view of what to do with Grangemouth. And I, knowing a little about how Jim Ratcliffe operates, that's not a huge surprise to me. I don't really have too much criticism for the Scottish Government here, because I do think that you've got to have quite a lot of things lined up to make this work. I think where I have concerns is that just we're dealing with the issue of just transition. It clearly didn't work in Grangemouth. So the announcement came with minimal participation of the workers. And if that's the template for how we go about this in the future, it's going to be a very difficult transition. And I think the challenge is, I think, that Scotland has marched ahead by making just transition a more core part of the overall strategy for climate than other parts of the UK. And that's a hugely beneficial thing to do. I think they deserve credit for that. But that only works, I suppose, if we've actually got it functioning. And it didn't seem to work, at least from the outside for me, it didn't seem to work at Grangemouth. I think there is still a future for Grangemouth as a petrochemical plant, and that is very much something that we can see in a net zero future, but it still needs that investment and you still need the participation of workers in the discussion. And I think the last thing I'll say on this is that there are still difficult discussions to have in what is an oil and gas industry. And what we typically see with the oil and gas sectors, although all the fossil fuel sectors generally, is that employment is often highly localised around them. So overall, the transition from fossil fuels to something cleaner doesn't look like a major employment issue for the country as a whole, but the employment impacts where they happen tend to be located, very close to particular geographies. And that therefore means you've got to get in there early and start talking about that future and investing in it. Otherwise, there isn't an easy discussion at all about the jobs in that area.
So, yeah, big lessons to learn there. In your report, I know you do mention the Just Transition Commission, because they raise concerns about the minimal engagement with workers, the community and government in terms of the Petrianios announcement. The Just Transition Commission has also emphasised that the difference between investment in net zero and investment in just transition. Is this a distinction that you think the Scottish Government sufficiently understands?
I mean, I think they understand it. I mean, I suppose maybe I might make a general point here, is that my belief is actually that the fairness issues, if I can call them that, rather than just transition issues, because just transition, I think, is more closely linked with the employment story. I mean, we could go into lots of depth about what it means, but the fairness issues across the piece, essentially who pays and how much are we asking, how we allocate costs and how we allocate the benefits, I think they are the most important issue now for net zero. If you stand back from it as a country, there's definitely no doubt we can hit net zero, and there's no doubt in my mind, at least all the work I've done shows you that there's a big economic return for that. But in the short term particularly, there are costs for those investments that we talked about, and there are shifts required in employment. And we've got to be prepared to look in a very clear-sighted way at what those things are to see those benefits in the future. And I think whether that's, you call that just transition or not, I think you almost need to start from the fairness questions if you want to see that a successful transition take place. And I think it's important to say we've still got time to do this. I mean, Grangemouth is maybe the first clue that the events are going to overlap. They may run ahead of where we need to be on all this. But the transition in buildings, the transition in transport, the transition in farming, the transition in other industries hasn't yet started. So we've got, not in any scale anyway, and we've got time to plan for this properly. So I think if we don't take the outlook at the start of this, that fairness needs to be one of the driving factors for that, it's just not going to stick. So I worry a lot about that.
Just add on that. We've touched on the fairness point actually throughout the discussion this morning, and what different things cost, what benefits might be, and so on. But it's like, we start from particular actions and then start talking about the fairness. But I think maybe just to reinforce Chris's point, it's all got to be part of the whole debate. And it's got to be, it's fundamental to the whole of government policy, actually. These things have got to come all together. Action across the whole economy. Net zero is emissions reduction is an essential thing for every government on the planet. And it's up to government to kind of do it in the right way and make sure it happens. And in the right way means addressing these fairness issues, and it means addressing all these things across all these different sectors. So we should not be seeing net zero policy as a kind of silo policy. Actually, it does affect everything that government does. And the fundamentals of what government does actually come back to fairness, representing citizens and and each individual's interests in the right sort of way. Those interests are served by addressing climate change. Our children and our grandchildren, we don't want to kind of leave a planet to them that is unlivable or is incredibly costly to live in. That's another part of the fairness thing. So it's a fairness across generations as well, even if it means that there's some generation, the present generation, some of us lot, maybe have to put our hands in our pockets and pay for something. But that's going to be to the benefit for the it's about fairness to the younger generations as well. So we've got to be willing to address that as a political class and a set of advisors and so on, as a holistic thing.
You made an important comment there about net zero shouldn't be siloed. In the case of the Scottish Government, has that been part of the problem?
I mean, drawing on my experience of knowing the Scottish Government in the past and where it is now, I mean, I think they've done more than any other government in the UK to drive net zero through as an agenda that sits in many different portfolios, but it's still not a finished position. I mean, I think I'm on the record today, actually, in an interview in The Guardian, saying that one of the challenges, I think, here is that the tag of net zero has taken on a kind of slogan. It's become a slogan, actually, rather than a scientific goal. And I sometimes worry about that, actually, because we need lots of things to happen at a pretty consistent pace now across all those portfolios. And if we get to the point where some of them do net zero and some of them don't, then I think it's going to be very difficult to make those changes. I'm more and more of the view that if we're going to get to net zero by 2045, we probably won't do so by solely making the arguments on a climate basis. That it is jobs, for example, in Falkirk that should drive you to make the investments to decarbonise Grangemouth, and the fact that it also helps the climate is a sort of secondary reinforcing concern. the fact that we are making homes warmer and reducing energy bills is the reason that we want to make the investment in buildings, and the fact that it helps the climate is the reinforcing thing. So I think getting to the point, I'm very, very happy if net zero steps into that reinforcing secondary role. We've still got to get to net zero. It's very important to do that. But we've been through quite an odd period, frankly, where, you know, the primary reason for a lot of this stuff was net zero alone. And, you know, that is a strategy that probably doesn't have that much longer to run, because there's big costs involved in some of these things. And we need to be doing the things that we need to do for reasons of jobs and energy security and warmer homes first and foremost, because that is typically in those portfolios the more driving factor for ministers. And that is fine. I think it is absolutely fine. It's a sort of, if we take net zero to be more of a background condition for all policy, it's far more likely that we'll have a successful transition, I think, overall.
Thank you. I agree. If we get it right, it's win-win-win across the board, really. Just then, on a more specific point, you'll be aware that the Scottish Government had announced, I think, £100 million for the green housing sector, and then some of that money, I think, shifted towards the offshore wind supply chain. And the former Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing Economy and Energy, Neil Gray, gave his reasons for that. Is it correct for the Scottish Government to prioritise support for the offshore wind sector ahead of the potential development of a green hydrogen sector? And where, in your view, are the best opportunities for economic growth in green industries in Scotland?
So green hydrogen depends on wind energy. I suppose it's the first thing you say. So you can't actually disentangle them. You know, where's that low-carbon electricity going to come from? So whether to prioritise one or the other, I mean, I can say that they're co-dependent, actually. A lot of talk for a long time about trying to build up the supply chains for certainly offshore wind. It somehow hasn't quite happened yet, but we can see examples from other parts of the UK where investment can happen. And it starts to get, starts to get a bit complicated, because you're dependent then on UK government policy, such as, you know, the CFD auction rounds. Last year's didn't come up with anything for offshore wind, but it looks more promising in terms of the reserve price for the next auction. So hopefully that's all moving again. So all of that that pathway gives confidence. The locations, it's a bit of kind of uncertainty been injected in terms of where you're going to build offshore wind if you can. Obviously, a lot of work's already been done to scout out the sites, acquire the seabed licensing, leasing arrangements. But some of the kind of questions now coming up about electricity market reform potentially look kind of quite penal for locations in the north. And that's because there isn't enough electricity transmission network capacity to make use of all those locations in the north. So, see, now there's lots of different pieces which need to kind of all be well aligned to get everything, you know, unlocked. So if you can be confident that your investment in offshore wind in Scottish waters is going to be financially viable, which means you can sell the energy, then you can go ahead and start placing contracts. And if you've got a long, you know pathway of a whole set of developments you're going to make over a number of years, then you can start investing in the supply chain in Scotland. You know, opportunities for people to bid for, you know, the steel manufacturing or the blades or, you know, the fabrication or whatever it might happen to be. So, it's a long answer to say it's kind of complicated from as I see it. And the dependencies are with the Scottish Government as well. Of course, the outcomes are what we want, you know, back to where you started from, you know, in terms of jobs in Scotland. Chris, anything to add
just
to that?
I think it's a really good idea that we have a strategy for green hydrogen production in this country. It will be an important part of the energy system going forward, in particular, because actually you can use it in the power system itself. It's a very useful way of balancing the power system, and we're going to be, you know, we'll need that, I think, as a way of generating electricity and from low-carbon means. The one thing I want to say is that I suppose the Scottish Government has plans to be a big export industry for hydrogen. I'm rather more dubious about that, and I wouldn't want us to hitch our wagon to that particular horse, to use probably the wrong analogy here, but without some serious thought on that. There's an energy strategy due this year. I don't think it is that likely that we will be exporting lots and lots of hydrogen, because hydrogen itself is quite a hard thing to export. And if you can string a length of cable from a wind farm to, say, Germany, that's probably easier than putting hydrogen on a boat and selling it and selling them hydrogen. Germany might produce its own hydrogen at the end of that cable, but it's easier to do that domestically. So I think the more that we put the focus on electricity in the system, the better. And that, for Scotland, is definitely an offshore wind strategy. It's an extremely, it's an amazing resource that we have there in Scotland, and we should be using it.
That's helpful. Thank you both. I need to move on to governance, because I had a question in this area. Just keen to hear how well you think the government is set up to deliver on its climate policy goals, and if you think there's anything that should be done differently. I'm also mindful of the Auditor General report of April last year, how the Scottish Government is set up to deliver climate change goals, and that's all about governance and risk management arrangements. I know, Chris, in particular, you know the Scottish Government well from previous roles. Should it be concerning that there was no permanent Director General for Net Zero until January of last year? We came back to Parliament after the election in May 21. There wasn't a permanent DG for Net Zero in that time, and we've had a few years without that portfolio area having a workforce plan. You know, have we seen some time and really important opportunities wasted in that period?
I mean, I don't particularly. I mean, I know Roy Bannon, the DG, pretty well, and he was doing the job on a temporary basis, on an interim basis, before he got it, on a permanent basis. So I think, in a sense, there hasn't really been a change of leadership within the Scottish Government on this. There has been some shift in the ministerial portfolios alongside that. So I don't know if there's been a gap. That's not really my experience. I think, the Scottish Government's actually been pretty good on this. In particular, the broader question of the governance of this, they've actually stepped in to address the governance challenge of local authorities more explicitly than we've seen down south. I think the overall challenge is we haven't got a plan. So, you know, it's hard to lead something when you haven't got a plan to lead. So, again, I'm back to, I realise I've said this a few times this morning, but without that kind of plan, I think Roy Brannan has a very difficult job to act as the SRO for it, because, you know, you've got to actually have something to deploy that involves, you know, a serious thought about what we're going to spend money on in this country, what the minister wants to see happen. All of that has been held up by the fact that we haven't seen the plan from the Scottish Government. So back to my irritation that we haven't seen the plan. The main irritation I have is that everything is gummed up by the fact we haven't got it written down. So, you know, I think the quicker we move to something that looks more like that, the better. And I know Roy, particularly given his previous history working in the transport sector, will find it a lot easier to then get his big Gantt charts out, because he's good at that stuff. So it's a really good. He'll be a great DG when we get to that point.
And I'll be clear, I wasn't picking out one individual, but if I look at the key message in the Audit Scotland report, you know, messages 1 and 2, it talks about a lack of frequent and consistent reporting, alongside gaps in performance monitoring, making it difficult to gain assurance of overall progress, and very much talking about on page 1 the lack of that workforce plan, and again saying that systematic risk management is needed so government can identify the key risks to meeting its climate change goals and take effective action to address them. And given what's happened last week, you know, people may think that's a factor that has contributed. I think to give a more balanced view, I think Audit Scotland told the committee fairly recently that they're happier now, but do we need to look back at that period, and is that a lesson that maybe we need to make sure that local government, other public bodies, that everyone is getting their house in order so that we can have that proper governance that we need?
Just back to one of the main themes of this morning about, you know, having a plan, a climate change plan, and why we haven't got a climate change plan. I mean, part of the explanation of that is very difficult to come up with a plan that meets, you know, the 2030 target, certainly as it looks now. But should we be in a position where a failure of a plan to do everything means you've got no plan to do anything? And we shouldn't be in that position. So, yeah, it makes it easier for government officials to work to a plan, if they've got one, and there should be a plan to do a big part of what we should be doing. But then there's another question is that, well, how much, to what extent have they already got a plan to do the things we can do?
Does that exist? Does that exist in sufficient detail? We arguably can see that in the policies that have been rolled out, and there's some positive things. We talked about, you know, the heat strategy and so on. So clearly that is those are the fruits of officials' labour to a very large extent, guided, approved by ministers. So there should be kind of more of that kind of thing, of being evident policies that are developed. So it's a bit of a kind of circular argument about, well, we haven't got a plan because we don't meet the target. Well, we should have a plan. And who was supposed to be producing the plan anyway? It's the same people who are going to act on the plan to a very large extent. So I don't think the kind of the 2030 target should be seen as an excuse, in short.
Thank you. Back to the convener, I think, for time. Monica,
now I'm going to slightly change the order just to give fair warning, because I know Mark is at home. So I'm going to bring Douglas in, then Mark, and then I'm going to bring in Ben. And the reason Mark has been struggling a wee bit, I think, with a bug. So we're delighted he's at home, but delighted he can contribute. So Douglas next.
Yeah, thanks, convener. It was just ahead of the announcement the Scottish Government gave last week. Did it come to you for advice or to pre-warn you of that announcement that was going to be made?
We had some contact with the officials. No, we were not privy to the details of the announcement before it was made, but we had some sense that they were going to look at the targets, because we'd essentially said that they should do so. The other aspect of it, and again, this, I'm very happy to give them the praise they deserve for this, is that they are moving. They told us they would be moving away from annual targets towards something that looked more like carbon budgets. And that is a very important step, I think. Annual targets, on the face of them, have the appeal of clarity. You have a percentage number to hit each year, but they're at the mercy of, you know, events. And, you know, we have consistently missed those annual targets under the Climate Change Act, which I think renders them pretty unimportant. And, you know, we've all sat through various ministers come and apologise to the House, in the chamber for missing that target. It's much better to look over a cycle at what needs to be done. And the UK has five-year carbon budgets. 5 years is quite a good term to look at, because essentially usually you'll have some sort of economic cycle over that period. You'll even out changes in temperature, so, you know, cold years and hot years where you might use more or less fossil fuels, and you'll also have a political cycle. So, you know, they came to us to tell us they were planning to look at that, and that we will provide advice on you know, the best way to approach the target setting in the future.
I guess in terms of legislation, I think some other colleagues are going to ask about that, Camilla.
We will see, and if they don't, I'm sure I can bring you back in, Douglas. So I think I would go to Mark next. Mark, it's your turn.
Yeah, thanks very much, convener. And sadly, I've got the Climate Change Committee logo at home. So I just wanted to go in again then on that advice around the five-year carbon budgets, and go back to the point that you were making at the beginning of the session, Chris. I mean, what is the Climate Change Committee's view on that? Because I think we've heard some, you know, criticism from Piers Forster about dropping the interim targets, effectively 2030 and 2040. But what you've just said there is that you actually think moving towards a five-year carbon budget and moving away from the annual targets makes sense if, you know, the action is batched together into climate change plans, and that it's backed up with strong advice from the Climate Change Committee. So can you offer a bit of clarity as to what your view is on that in terms of the interim targets, what happens to those, and how that relates then to the five-year budget?
Yeah, so my organisation will provide advice on this formally in the coming months, but I'm happy to give you my view on it. And if you're looking for any evidence of what the CCC's view on this, we did a similar piece of advice to the Welsh Government when they were conceiving of a different approach to climate change a few years back. And what we said to them is what I think we will end up saying to the Scottish Government, that carbon budgets, as in looking at, you know, the carbon that is emitted over a longer period than a year, is a sensible step. So if we have an idea of a carbon budget every 5 years, or maybe even a shorter period, that steps down over time towards the long-term goal of net zero, that tends to give you more certainty about the actions that need to be taken within each of those periods to deliver the target. And it allows you to ride through the problem that we've seen in Scotland, which is that there are big fluctuations year to year, most notably, actually, how cold it is. You know, if you, you know, biggest one of the biggest sources of emissions in Scotland is the fossil fuels that we burn to keep our homes and buildings warm. If you have a cold year, they go up, right? So we do adjust for that in some of the stats, but you know, you get these kind of fluctuations that over 5 years do even themselves out. And I think the other thing is that this point about the economic cycle also evens out over the five-year period, that you get typically a dip in the economy and then some sort of increase in economic output. And those are often linked to greenhouse gas emissions. So again, having a target that looks across that is just easier to manage. So I suspect, I mean, I won't be in charge when we produce this advice, but we will come in strongly behind the idea of a carbon budget approach as opposed to annual targets. Whether that means we need to abandon interim targets, the decadal targets that we have for 2030, 2040, 2045, well, that'll be for the committee to decide. I do see the value in having them. And I think it's worth saying that, in a sense, what we have at UK level, which is, I think, a model that works pretty well, is that we have the carbon budgets for the UK and we have the net zero goal for 2050. I'll say again, 2050 took goal for 20 is exactly the same as 2045 for Scotland. Scotland will get to net zero sooner if the UK is on its path to 2050. So there's not an expression of more ambition for Scotland in having 2045 in law. But we also have at UK level what's known as the 2030 NDC, which is our nationally determined contribution to the Paris process. It is a percentage number by 2030. And it's tremendously useful to have that, actually. We do a lot of work around what that would require. And so having these milestones alongside the carbon budget, I think, can also work. So the carbon budgets alone are one way into this, but I think there is still room for us to have a 2030 target and a 2040 target. It will be for the committee to decide whether they agree with that.
Okay. So in terms of that advice then, when are you able to issue that advice to both the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament? Because I think when we were setting targets in the 2019 Act, there perhaps wasn't that kind of formal, solid advice that was coming. I think if we're going to legislate again the climate targets, we'd need to have that, you know, cast iron advice coming from UKCCC in time for dealing with the legislation that's coming to Parliament.
My main regret, actually, is that I won't be around to see the publication of what's known as the 7th carbon budget advice from the CCC. It's always the most exciting piece of work that we do. Every 5 years, we give a piece of advice on the path ahead for the whole of the UK to what is now the long-term goal of net zero. The last time we did that was 2020 with the 6th carbon budget advice. And, you know, it was tremendous to be involved in that work. And as part of that work, we will define a path ahead, a pragmatic, achievable, but ambitious path ahead for reducing emissions for the whole of the United Kingdom. And we will have a pathway for emissions aligned with that for Scotland alone. And we will do lots of work to illustrate what that requires in Scotland alongside the path itself. That will be ready early next year. And the reason that we've brought that work forward, we would typically do it by the end of the calendar year, but we decided to do it early next year because we expect that to be early in the next Westminster Parliament. So we want it to be something that a new set of ministers of whatever colour receive and have something to chew over. So that means that for Scotland, we'll have a brand new pathway that has all those hallmarks of pragmatism and ambition ready for probably February, March next year. So we're in quite an interesting moment, I suppose, where the Cabinet Secretary has told the Scottish Parliament that she wishes to remove those interim targets. My desire now, strangely, given my point earlier about the vacuum, is that my strong advice is that we've got to hold open that space for the numbers to be set until the CCC has done its work next year. Otherwise, we will end up in the position that we ended up before, where we saw Scottish politics, if I can put it that way, name a target that was ahead of anything that we could illustrate with analysis. That does not mean, though, that we can't make progress on the target framework itself before then. So I think there is a piece of advice that we can offer before we do the pathway with the numbers that would also set out why we feel carbon budgets are a good approach and something that could be usefully added into the Scottish Climate Change Act. So I think you could see this, I suppose, as a two-stage process where we give you some advice on the right institutional arrangements, the right legislative arrangements, and then we fill in the right targets and the right carbon budgets and the right numbers when the pathway analysis is available early next year.
I like that framing of it, to have the framework defined, fill in the numbers, properly scrutinised numbers, properly developed as we are doing. when they arrive. I think keeping the positive debate in the meantime, so not committing to something that isn't deliverable, but making sure that, as we've talked about repeatedly this morning, that action is still going on, it still remains really important. My term as a member of the Climate Change Committee, you know, it's a five-year term, it was at, you know, everything's built around 5 years, isn't it? Was ended, actually, at the end of last month, but with nothing having been done, I think, to recruit my replacement, I was offered another year, so this, which I'm very glad to do. So, you know, it's tremendously interesting, rewarding, challenging work, and it is challenging now because there's a huge amount to be done in to prepare this seventh carbon budget, I mean, quicker than would have been the case. So, bear with us while we get that very kind of deliberate advice formed.
No, I appreciate that and appreciate your points about needing to learn from the 2019 Act as well and the process around setting targets there. Can I just ask you then finally about the package? I mean, you offered quite a few reflections on the climate package, the kind of early climate package, I guess, that was announced last week around the intent to legislate as well. And you've already spoken at length about heat and the positivity around the Heat and Buildings Programme and how that's going to get us on the right trajectory, not to meet 2030, but certainly to meet 2045 targets. Can I ask you about if there are any other elements of that package you want to comment on? You've already spoken about Grangemouth, for example. There is a commitment in the package to see a just transition plan for Moss Moran that will be early, that will involve workers. There's also been a commitment to finally roll out passenger duty, air departure tax as well. So I wonder if there's anything else in that package you want to reflect on as potentially signalling a change in government policy or an acceleration that's welcome.
And there on the, you could say the land and rural questions as well, which I think is very welcome. There's quite an intriguing commitment to doing something potentially on a new carbon land tax, which is something that we haven't seen before. So I think there's lots to be excited about there. And if you throw in the consultation on heat and buildings, that is potentially quite a meaty package. I mean, the challenge, I think, is actually delivering against all these things. So what we have at the moment is an annex to a letter, and we've got some sense of what would be in that package. All of it looks good. But I don't know, and I'm leading up to the point I really want to make on this, is that once again, I'm afraid, we have a set of commitments with no numbers next to them. And I just don't think it's good enough any longer to produce that. We have to know what kind of impact is expected from these policies. So I don't know how much impact this thing will have, because I don't understand what kind of greenhouse gas emission reductions are expected to be associated with those policies. So let us hope when we see the policies, there is more by way of analysis alongside it, because that was the mistake in the past. A load of open-ended commitments that wasn't clear how they would be delivered and no numbers next to them, and then an annex completely divorced from the policies at the back of a publication that had some different numbers in it that you could add up to hit the targets. I don't think that cuts the mustard any longer. So we need to know what is actually going to be delivered through these proposals, and then we can do the job of assessing that independently, which I'm sure we'll do well.
And you'd expect that to obviously come within the next climate plan. So I think one of the criticisms you made a number of years ago was that the previous climate plan didn't have the numbers in it. So you're expecting the next climate plan to have, hard figures as to what each and every policy programme will deliver in the years to come.
So I think it's great that the minister is promising it, but I want to see it. So, and I'm sure I'm not the only one who feels that way about it. So until we see that, until we understand the numbers behind it, I wouldn't be able to say whether it's an impactful package or not.
Okay, thanks, Camille.
Thanks very much, Mark. Ben, I think you've got a question, then I've got a question.
I've got two questions, Camille.
Oh, well, there you go, two.
Thank you. Just first of all, going back to the five-yearly carbon budget approach rather than annual targets, I appreciate you've clarified that you will provide proposals having considered the Welsh situation previously, but I just wondered in terms of the practicalities and the process for setting five-yearly carbon budgets and that approach, if there's anything more you want to add at this stage about the challenges and just how you envisage that working through government and parliament.
I mean, we can draw on some experience here, because we've got carbon budgeting happening now at UK level and at Welsh level. And I hope shortly at Scottish level too. Northern Ireland has a slightly different view, but it's similarly based on the idea of periods of carbon reduction. The experience of UK and Wales particularly is that you need to go through a process of establishing first how this is going to work. So this idea that there is a five-year cycle becomes established as part of the sort of rhythm of government. You can introduce it, but you've got to actually go through that process, I think, before it becomes well established. And the success, I think, of the UK carbon budgets is that the initial carbon budgets were challenging but achievable. And we've also got to go do that in Scotland too. So I think we will almost certainly see that the short-term ambition is not going to be as great as the people who stood behind the 75% target for 2030 in this Parliament. You've got to warm up supply chains, you've got to warm up delivery in a host of areas, and that takes time, and you've got to have the policy in place, and people have got to be confident to do it. And you then get the payoff after 2030. So the path ahead for Scotland is going to be determined, I hope, by those carbon budgets. But the effort involved in them might not be shown by the carbon budgets, if you see what I mean. So the policy that we put in place in Scotland over the next 5 years is probably not going to have a huge impact on emissions. The impact on emissions will come later. So I wouldn't be surprised if you see a pathway for Scotland in those carbon budgets that initially looks like quite a shallow reduction in emissions and then quite a deep reduction later. And I think this is the key thing I'm trying to say to you, is that if we only look at emissions in the short term, you're unlikely to put the right policy package in place. We need policy makers in the Scottish Government and beyond that in other parts of government too, to take the long-term view that we're going to deliver big emissions reductions after 2030 and into the 2040s even. And to do that, you've got to put in place the structural elements of that now, despite the fact they don't deliver you huge emission savings in the short term. So the beauty of carbon budgeting is you should know where you're heading and you should be able to follow a trajectory to that. But everyone in the system's got to understand that. I think we're more or less there with UK policymaking on that, but the Scottish Government will have to get up to speed on how that works, and that's been the experience in Wales as well.
Considering the politics, the fact the Scottish Parliament has 5 yearly parliamentary terms might be quite helpful in that regard as well.
That's the beauty of it, though. I mean, in a sense, the point is that in the Climate Change Act, UK or Scottish, you've got an idea that something must be done that goes beyond that parliamentary cycle, and that it is the responsibility of government in each of those parliamentary cycles to keep the show on the road. And that is easier with carbon budgets, I think, because you're pointing towards a thing that will, go into the next parliament, the one after it and the one after that. And, you then have a duty on that government to do the right things in that parliament. I mean, I think the key point I'm trying to make is that it may be that the Scottish Government in the next political cycle doesn't achieve huge amounts of emissions reduction, but they still need to put in place a lot of the big elements that would achieve that. Think of the discussion we just had on decarbonising buildings, for example. That is not going to deliver you a big emissions savings in the next 5 to 10 years, but it will over the next 20 years. So, that idea needs to be built in, that the carbon budgets keep the show on the road, essentially. And, there's lots of room for politics to determine different ways through this, but overall, the emissions shape of this is where we're heading.
There's just one point I might just chip in on the carbon budgets. I think at a UK level, we haven't yet seen controversy around the carbon budgets that have already, the time has passed because they've been met. That's actually good. We don't want to be getting into a position where there's lots of argument about why they've not been met. But that's going to get harder because the initial budgets were set on an 80% reduction of greenhouse gases and the sixth carbon budget was set on a 100% reduction, getting to net zero by 2050. So it's more stretching. So we'll have to see how that pans out. But we don't want to have to wait and kind of argue about why we missed it. We want to, of course, put the pieces in place to make sure we hit it.
And talking about that sense of collective challenge and purpose, and the political discourse, Chris Stark, you I thought made some really powerful points on the BBC at the weekend. And as this is your last time in this role at our committee, I wanted to give you the chance to say anything further that you might want to on the collective challenge of our discourse and how we need to work collaboratively in that. And not just to all of us round the table, but to every politician in this building, every researcher and press officer behind the scenes, every journalist, every campaigner and researcher for the many stakeholders involved in these considerations. How do we get our collective discourse and position into a better place?
Chris, sorry, just to say, you don't have to make a separate address to each one of those people or groups of people.
I think it would be
just
a very long
address. We are quite short of time, and I want to bring monitoring.
Of course.
But, yeah.
I've worked on climate policy now for, I think, 13 years. It's my final week, so I've been saying goodbye to lots of people, and I've been thinking about a lot about that. The thing with climate politics, if you'll indulge me, I will talk about politics, despite being a technocrat. We're in that political system, and I observe it. The privilege of this job is to observe it and be part of it. And that's what I was talking about on BBC and the Laura Koonsberg show. I think of climate politics a bit like a sort of sawtooth, if you can think of it that way. We make progress, and then inevitably it will fall back a little. It never falls back to where we started. We keep making that progress. And I suppose that is part of the political cycle on climate politics. And we've been through one of those political cycles on political politics, on climate politics in the time I've done this job. So in the 6 to 7 years I've done this job, you could think of it as kind of two halves, basically. The first half is all about raising the ambition. I'm very, very proud that we did this piece of work that led to the setting of a net zero target for Scotland and the UK. I like to think it was in large part because of the quality of the analysis that we produced, but I know that it was also due to the fact that there was a pressure from civil society to want to see that target implemented. So we had this very progressive discussion, positive discussion about the benefits of acting more ambitiously on climate change. And the second half of my job naturally has been a little harder, as we've seen, I'll say it, there's been a backlash. But more or less the show's stayed on the road, to use the term I used earlier. What do I learn from that? I think we make most progress when there is a positive discussion of this. And my biggest concern in what you might call the backlash era is that we've left this vacuum I spoke about at the start of my appearance with you today. And the usual voices against climate action have filled that vacuum. And again, I'm the Guardian today. I'm talking about one of those issues. One of the ways in which that has manifested is that net zero as a term has been captured by culture warriors as something that we should be afraid of now. This is something that is projected now as an issue that is a threat to livelihoods, a threat to society by some quarters. And that is, I'm afraid, rubbish. And we haven't got a positive discussion around net zero any longer in the way that we used to. And we've got to recapture it. I do think that it's important for our political leaders to step in to fill that with a more positive discourse around the benefits of climate action. So I know how hard that is, because you've got to face down some of those voices, and I experienced that myself personally in this job. But the benefits to this country of achieving net zero are immense, and they're not just benefits to the climate. They're benefits in the form of jobs, they're benefits to the landscape that we see around us, they're benefits to trade, they're benefits to a host of issues, social issues with them. And they are the reasons, I think, why you should want to pursue net zero alongside the climate benefits. But we will not see those benefits unless we have a brand of political leadership, no matter what party you represent, where you're willing to step up and talk about this and willing to step up and talk about the impacts that we're now seeing from climate change too as a threat. And I said to Laura Koonsberg at the weekend that I feel that is the biggest issue. There is a collective fear of talking about climate because of these voices that are speaking out against it, the voices of populism. And I really wish we could get back to the positive discourse that we had a few years ago on this, because it felt like we were really motoring. Scotland's part of that too. So I suppose since you gave me the platform, my message to you all is please feel emboldened to do it. It will be good for us all if you do.
Thank you.
Monica.
I don't want to lower the mood, because I think you're trying to take us to quite a positive place there, Chris. And you will be missed in this role, but you opened the session by talking about a dangerous moment that we find ourselves at. We heard the reaction last week from charities and veteran climate campaigners that scrapping the 2030 climate targets, we heard from Oxfam that's a global embarrassment. We heard from Friends of the Earth Scotland that this is the worst environmental decision in the history of the Scottish Parliament. So people who know the climate science and know the importance of getting this right and know the opportunities and the prize that awaits us, they're not taking this well, and they're certainly not exaggerating. So to get this back on track, because you've basically talked about a climate act is in danger of being an empty vessel. We've got blank pages where we should have really good and bold policies. We've had a Scottish Government that's had 15 years to deliver transformative action. So how do we get this back on track if it looks like there's been a real lack of political courage? There's going to be a lot of debate and discussion in this Parliament. There's motions of no confidence. There's a Bute House agreement in jeopardy. How do politicians find the courage? What advice can you give to government and to Parliament on that?
Well, I think it's for politicians to decide where they find their courage, because I think you're all nuts. So it's an incredibly difficult job being a politician, someone who's worked with them, you know, all through my career. But on this, there's such a sort of weight of evidence of the benefits of all this now that, I mean, we are as an institution quite conservative in our outlook about the benefits of this. But, you know, I tell you what, we could be far more positive, and I believe that to be where we will actually end up. And I think it's good that we have a conservative climate change committee in the way that we view the transition. But everything tells you, actually, the transition is now really taking hold and you want to be part of that. So I think the kind of, if any encouragement I can give you is to own that story, actually, that this is something that's just, it is good for the climate, but it's also good for the economy and it's good for people living in this country. And on the point about the empty vessel, the reason I think it's dangerous is because if we don't see real progress on policy over the, you know, the next 12 months, you know, you've got, as you say, the Bute House agreement potentially under threat. There's a host of things that could happen between now and our advice on the pathway that, you know, could leave us in a very difficult position where there is not the same consensus across the chamber here to act on climate change. I think that would be a disaster. So I think all eyes on the Scottish Government, but also all encouragement on the Scottish Government to produce good policy on this in the next period and demonstrate that there is genuine commitment to act on climate change. And if that has broad consensus and political support across the party divides, then we'll be all right. You know, I think this is going to be a decent period of progress. And I retweeted yesterday something that Mary McCallum said, which is that she feels that the 2030 target is now has been a block to producing the climate change plan. Okay, well, we've removed it now. So let's get the plan out. Let's actually see good, strong policy on this stuff that has broad support. And then we'll come back to the targets and what I hope will be I'll be an observer of the work that we produce, but a really important piece of work from the Climate Change Committee that has the right numbers in it this time for the pathway. We won't make the mistake of overheating those targets again. It's such an important year to do that.
Thank you.
I would just second all that. To echo the call that Chris made about, you know, politicians to feel like, you know, you can really own the debate, get involved in it, make the case. As a technocrat, I want to see those numbers that we talked about earlier. You know, the policies that should be going on anyway, that were always going to be part of the transition that we should be doing now. Let's see the detail, let's see the numbers, and let's see the policy delivered.
Okay, I'm going to just come to the last question, if I may. I'm not sure how I'm going to phrase it, having just been told I'm nuts or all politicians are nuts. So on that basis, Chris, I'm trying to see from the committee's point of view that we're going to get new legislation to replace the 2000 or amend the 2019 Act, and you're suggesting that it's going to be on a carbon budget basis rather than a climate change plan target basis. So one's going to be scrapped to replace the other. Now, we have heard from the People's Panel who gave us a report just last week, I think it was, that we're not hearing enough information from the government on detail. And I guess, should as a committee, do you think we would expect in that amended legislation the first carbon budget figures? Because to actually scrutinise legislation with just knowing there's going to be a change and something's going to be brought forward in the future, I think it's going to be a really hard sell to all those people that have written into us. And let me tell you, there are lots and lots and lots of them, Chris.
Too. So if my postbox is anything to go by, I'm sure there's a lot. It is difficult. I mean, I really do feel that it is important not to fill in the numbers on that pathway until we've done our work, because repeating what we talked about earlier. a mistake was made before in setting that 75% target, and it was because we didn't have the benefit of the pathway analysis that we set that target, and it's really hard to get on these pathways. So I hope we're able to hold open the space where the numbers get filled in early next year. Prior to that, though, I think a couple of things will help. Two or three things. Let's say first of all, I think we can provide advice on the appropriate carbon budgeting arrangements, so that you know that you don't need the numbers for that. You can set up the legislation in the right way for that. You can have a debate about how that will work. So that's useful. We are also promised by the minister the continuation of an annual update, which is a really important part of that. So we'll still know from the minister and from the Scottish Government what they are achieving in policy terms. We also have the plan itself. And if you're looking for a guide for what kind of reductions would be necessary, we've also provided that for you in the last piece of work that we did based on our 2020 analysis. We updated that 18 months ago with some extra information to make it more appropriate for Scotland. So there is at least a loose guide about the trajectory that Scotland will need to follow from the CCC, but that will all be updated in early 2025. So, you know, I wouldn't follow it to the letter, but I think that will give you some sense about the emissions reductions that we need to achieve with the policies that are promised from the Scottish Government over the next year. I realise it's not ideal, but you know, I think by the start of next year we'll be in a much better place if we have carbon budgeting in place, we have a pathway that's been advised by the CCC, and we have a committed policy programme with numbers in it. To make Keith's point again, it's got to have the numbers in it, otherwise we won't know where we are.
I just think it's going to be quite difficult to take evidence on a bill and making changes to a system which had some certainty, even if you did consider it unachievable, to go to something with you know, promise of jam in the future without knowing what those figures are. And you've already said to us today that carbon budgets will have a fairly soft landing in the first couple of years. So it may be a real concern. And I guess it's going to be interesting to see how Parliament is going to deal with it. And I can't make a comment on that. And Chris, sadly, you're not going to be here to comment on that, because this is your last week. I think you finish on Friday. And I think you said to me that you're starting a new job on Monday. So I don't know if that's no peace for the wicked or just absolutely keeping your options open as far as working is concerned. So we wish you the best of luck. I think you've always been a candid friend to the committee and told us things that we might not like to hear. So I'm very grateful for that. And I'm grateful that we had this extra opportunity. And I guess, Keith, when it comes to you, that having heard that you've extended till April next year, I'm not going to say goodbye to you, because I think there's a very, very good chance that we will see you in the future, even if it's at the year-end assessment, or maybe before, depending on what's on.
Hopefully I would have got over this cough by the time I see you again.
So
you might not make it, you know.
Well, he might have followed your line, Chris, that all politicians are nuts and that he wants out. So on that basis, thank you very much, and we're going to move into private session. Thank you.